Good mid-morning. I would like to welcome you to our budget session. This is a special meeting where we are going to be presented with the superintendent's budget, so there is no place on the agenda for public comments. We are very happy to see so many of our community members and our students and our school leaders here at our meeting. Winston, will you lead us in the open our meeting by leading us in the Pledge of Allegiance?
Will you please rise?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
If you'll remain standing for a moment of silence, please. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. We are now at approval of the agenda. Is there a motion?
So moved.
I second it.
All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? All right, Superintendent Contreras, I'll turn it over to you and you'll direct your staff as necessary.
Thank
and,
you.
And if you could talk about the format and process for our
budget.
Yes, ma'am.
She will. That's part of her presentation.
Thank you.
I'd like to introduce Angie Henry, the Chief Financial Officer, who will be presenting my budget recommendations.
I'm just pause for just a minute for protocol. I apologize. Our Chair of the County Commissioners, Alan Branson, is with us, and I want to recognize our elected officials. So thank you for being here, Alan. I'm sorry, you can proceed, Superintendent.
Thank you.
Good morning. We're going to start this morning's meeting by going through the superintendent's budget recommendation. You do have this PowerPoint in the appendices of your budget book that you received. So we'll just start going through the presentation. First thing we want to talk about when we talk about the budget for Guilford County Schools is to look at trends for funding K-12 education in Guilford County over the last several years. You know that most of our funding for operations comes from the state. Over 60% of our funding typically comes from the state. So when we look at how the state has funded K-12 education over the last 50 years, you can see in 69-70, more than 50% of the state's operating budget or general fund budget was spent on K-12 education. In 18-19, that number was down to 39.5%. If we were at the same percentage as we had been 50 years ago, K-12 education would have an additional $3 billion among all of our education agencies for our students. When we look at the dollars that we're spending in K-12 education at the state level, you can see we've gone from $6.13 billion in 2003-04 up to $9.44 billion in 2018-19. So you'll hear the state legislators say that we're spending more on education than we ever have before. But when we look on how those dollars are being spent, you'll see that some of these dollars aren't making it into resources in the classroom for our students. If you can look at this chart, this shows that in 2008-2009, we had statewide student enrollment in local education agencies of 1.44 million. And that yielded, with the allotment formula, almost 68,000 teachers for those 1.4 million students. If you look across the time since 2008-2009 to 2018-19, our current budget year, you can see while our student enrollment has not grown significantly, we still are at 1.44 million student membership across the state. However, we're down to a little over 66,000 teachers. And that is even with the increase that the legislators passed in the 18-19 appropriations bill to start funding enhancement teachers. For the current year, we've received 25% of that allotment formula, but that doesn't even bring us up to the same level of teachers as we were in 2008-2009. Also included, just for your information on this chart, is the statewide charter school membership, So that you can see, these numbers are not included in the statewide membership, school membership, but you can see how charter school enrollment has grown across the state in this same time period. Again, when we look at other categories that the state funds with their general fund dollars, if we use the same formulas that were in place in 2008-2009 and apply those to our 2018-19 allotted ADM from the state, you would see that we would have almost 65 or 66 more teachers. We'd have 30 more instructional support positions. Those are our media specialists, our counselors, our social workers. We'd have one more principal. We'd have almost 17 more assistant principal positions. We'd have $4.5 million more dollars in teacher assistance. We'd have $2 million each in classroom materials and supplies, as well as textbooks. We also would still have our mentor pay and our staff development pay, which have now been completely eliminated from state funding. So you can see, again, while the state's saying they're, and they are spending more in dollars in K-12 education, those dollars are not showing up in the resources. But if you look at the next two part, the bottom part of this chart, you'll see statewide average salaries that they have increased for all of these positions since 2008-2009. You also see the benefit cost increases have, as a percentage, have increased tremendously since 2008-2009. So those are where the dollars are going. Certainly our teachers and other staff certainly deserve and have earned the salary increase. And, you know, those dollars are well spent there, but we also need the additional dollars to support our other areas and resources for our students. When we look at our local funding, you can see since 2010-11, this chart includes county appropriation that we've received since 2010-11. And it also shows the Guilford County Schools. It's the final ADM for all years except the last 2 years reflected on this chart. We've also got charter school enrollment because, as you'll recall, these dollars have to be split between Guilford County Schools and all the students enrolled in charter schools that are reside in Guilford County. So we've got that, the total enrollment there, and so the per pupil appropriation amount is the county appropriation divided by the total enrollment. You can see how that per pupil amount has, how it started a downward kind of trend from 2010 up through 2013-14. It started increasing incrementally since then. And this year we are included in our budget recommendation is an increase of $10 million in the request from the county commissioners, which would increase that per pupil amount by $80 using the state's projected allotted ADM for Guilford County Schools and their projected enrollment for charter schools for Guilford County. When we look at where our per pupil expenditure is in Guilford County compared to other counties, and I know this is hard to read on the screen, it's hard to read in your printout, but we'll try. you can see when we look at 2018-19, we are 14th in the state. Last year we were 13th. When we look at 2010-11-12, which these numbers are provided in the table below the chart, if you can read that and kind of sort it, you'll see that in that year we were 9th in the state in per pupil funding. So we are continuing to slip backwards. If we slip further, much further, it's going to be, I may have to show this on two pages to be able to read it. But you can see also included in here are the percent changes in the per pupil expenditure from between 2011-12 and 2018-19, and I think that reflects what counties, some counties are doing to support schools in their districts. For capital outlay funding, and these are the dollars that we use to maintain our buildings across the districts, we've got 12 million square foot of building space to maintain. This year we received $6 million to maintain that. That's about 50 cents a square foot. I think the general rule when you're talking about homes, you're budgeting maintenance for your home, you generally budget about a dollar a square foot for homes. when we look at what we've seen, when we look at kind of industry standards for maintaining buildings across the country or at a national level, we've got from $1.48 a square foot up to $1.97. That would yield, if we applied that to our square footage rate, we would yield from 17 up to $24 million. We'd have that range. So when we look at the 2019-20 budget recommendation from the superintendent, we use the strategic plan goals to create our budget for 2019-20. We have the strategic plan priorities, the reimagining excellent schools, eradicating gaps, improving operational efficiencies, creating pathways to prosperity, and investing in our people. We've used those to guide and identify our budget priorities, which you'll see in this chart or here on the left. We've tied all of those priorities to a strategic plan goal and a strategic plan priority. Our first priority, salary and benefit increases for locally funded employees, that makes up the biggest part of the change in the budget for 1920. And we'll start that with looking at the anticipated teacher salary increase. We have budgeted 5% in anticipation of what the state's gonna do. That's we've anticipated, again, an average of 5%. For our locally funded teachers, that would cost us about $1.6 million. For our locally funded assistant principals, we again used an average of 5% salary increase, and that would cost us $900,000 for our locally funded assistant principals. For locally funded classified staff, which are our non-licensed, non-certified staff, we're anticipating a 3% average increase. For locally funded staff, that would cost us $1 million, and again, that's what we anticipate the state doing. In addition to what the state salary increases, we have included $2 million to try to increase the teacher supplement. This is part of a long-range plan to make our teacher supplement schedule more competitive with districts around us and across the state. We also have included $1 million to increase bus driver pay, to try to make our bus driver positions more attractive and try to fill those positions. This is an addition. The $1 million for bus driver pay is an addition to what would be included in the classified staff salary increase for locally funded staff for bus drivers. We also have included in our budget, however, it's not funded with local dollars, an increase for our school nutrition staff. All of our school nutrition expenditures are paid from our school nutrition fund, so those dollars will be in our school nutrition fund budget. We have health insurance increase. We're anticipating a cost of $700,000 for that. And then the retirement rate, we are anticipating a high retirement rate. The governor had proposed over 20% in his budget, and that's what we've used to calculate our increase for our local fund budget. However, if I had been projecting, I probably would have projected a little lower than that, but it's, I think we're better off using the governor's, just to be conservative, we're better off using the governor's rate. So that would cost us $2.6 million for our locally funded salaries. I want to point out, too, that that number is so high because it does include, our locally funded salaries does include the teacher supplements, the locally funded teacher supplements, and principal supplements as well. So that's why that number appears high compared to the number of staff that we are funding locally. When we look at our local teacher supplement, where we are compared to other counties, and these are certainly the counties that we're competing with to try to attract teachers to Guilford County Schools. In 2008-2009, we were sixth in the state with an average local supplement of $4,994. You can see where we're at now for 2017-18. We are ninth in the state. We don't have yet the numbers for 2018-19. So it's important to note that our number for 2017-18 does not include the $1.8 million that the board did include in their budget for 18-19 to increase the teacher supplement. We think that number will add to the 4764 and bring us up to about $5,000. So that would hopefully move us up one, but we don't know what other districts have done with their local supplements. We get calls very often as we're starting the budget process from other districts to ask us if we're increasing our supplement in our upcoming budget, so they can, you know, take that in consideration as other counties are developing their budget, because they're competing for the same teachers that we are. for that reason, again, we've got $2 million in this budget request or budget recommendation for teacher supplements. We are, our next priority is improving chronically low-performing schools. We've got $1 million included in the recommendation here. Two things that we're doing for improving the low-performing schools is we've changed the way we are allotting Title I. We're using a blended method that allows us to use the identified students that we use for CEP purposes, as well as the students who completed free and reduced applications. That changes the way the Title I allocations look. More schools are included. We've made the cutoff at 57%, whereas last year we were around 40%. So that's going to benefit our low-performing schools that need those resources. We also are continuing the elimination of combination classes in our lowest-performing schools. We started that for the current year. We'll continue doing that for next year. And then we also have the $1 million that we're requesting for the teacher recruitment retention incentive. If you'll recall, in the current year budget, we created a plan for teacher recruitment and retention at our schools with the lowest proficiency. This is the lowest proficiency in 16-17. We're going to continue to support those schools with these dollars. This year, we have the staff in those schools are receiving the $3,000 annual incentive for all the teaching staff in those nine schools that you see listed here. For 19-20, we need to have the dollars in our budget to provide the performance piece of this incentive. So when we get the test results in October, we'll have the dollars to reward the teachers that exceed growth with a $4,500 bonus. The ones that meet growth will receive $2,750. And then if the school increases a letter grade, all the teachers who are not eligible and don't have EVOS data will receive $1,000 each. So again, that's cost $1 million. We also have $3.1 million in the recommendation for sustaining operations. The biggest part of that you can see is the anticipated increase in charter school enrollment. We're projecting an increase of 574 students. That will cost the district $2.9 million. We've got a small increase for our liability insurance, and then the dollars that we had in this year's budget from appropriated fund balance to restore the day for bus drivers, that we're going to include that in the budget so we don't have to continue to use fund balance dollars for that. For our instructional resources, we're going to continue to use existing state, local, and federal dollars to replenish our K-8 literacy consumables and as well as our K-8 math consumables. We also have the addition of resources for Math 1. We'll be using these resources, the federal, state, and local dollars for. Same for our professional learning. We'll continue, and the board approved last week several of the contracts for professional learning for our coaching, for our school leaders, our teachers, but we've added Math 1 here as well. Consolidating schools. We are closing, the recommendation includes closing Hampton following the tornado that occurred on April 15th. As you'll recall, after that time, the students and staff were relocated at Reedy Fork Elementary School, where they spent the remainder of the 17-18 school year. We secured the undamaged portion of the Hampton school building in May 2018. The students at Hampton were provided the option to be reassigned to Simpkins, Faulkner. They were also provided the option to stay at Hampton, which would remain in the Reedy Fork Elementary School, or if they were a magnet student, they were offered the option of returning back to their home school. In April 2019, offered parents that wanted to transfer or contacted parents, and most wanted to transfer to Simpkins Elementary School or Faulkner Elementary School. Some of those parents desired a magnet option. So we're holding a public hearing to close Hampton on April 30th. That says 3019, but it's really 2019. Sorry about that. And then, just for board's information, the proceeds from insurance that we receive for those three buildings will be used for the design costs for a building at the new Hampton Peeler School. Also, we're looking at our Twilight program and reimagining it. If you look at this chart, you'll see that in the district, we have a little less than 500 dropouts each year for the last 3 years, and you can see what that percentage has been. In 2018-19, this year, and in years past, we've spent about $750,000 on staff, supplies, and transportation for this Twilight program, where it's being held there on Piscachurch Road. That's, with the students we've got enrolled right now, about 63 students, that's a cost of almost $12,000 per student. We can more efficiently spend those dollars, utilize those same dollars to serve from 240 up to 300 students in three different sites, one at Jackson Middle School, one at Pruitt Scale, one at Southern High School. These will be, students will be allowed to attend the one that's closest to them, and these sites are the ones closest to the schools with the highest dropout rates. That would get us to $3,125 per student if we serve 240 students with those same dollars. For Scale Greensboro, we are relocating the Scale School that is currently on Piscachurch Road to our Washington Street building. They're on Washington Street. That will allow our students to have access to PE facilities utilizing the Y, much like Weaver Education Center does. It also allow these co-curricular supervisors to be on the same site where these students are. Together, the savings for these three school changes, along with the continued savings at Irwin and Peeler sites, net us $2.7 million in savings. So when we look at the total local current expense fund changes to the budget as a whole, you can see the salary and benefit cost increases, along with the bus driver pay increase, cost $9.8 million. The cost of the chronically low performing schools, those incentives for those teachers, is $1 million. The sustaining operations is $3.1 million. There are no additional costs for the instructional resources or the professional learning. We are realizing a savings from consolidating schools of $2.7 million. The managed print services contract that you approved last month, we'll have savings of at least $200,000, maybe a little more, but we want to be conservative here. And Scott and his team are working very hard to identify savings in the transportation department of $1 million. So that nets to the $10 million increase that we're gonna recommend in county commissioner funding. Also, not included on here, but wanted to be sure to note that, again, because it's not in the local current expense fund, the school nutrition staffing salary increase or rate increase is not included on here, but it will be funded from the school nutrition fund. For capital outlay, we're recommending a request of $12 million. Most of that is for deferred maintenance, and we've prioritized that based on the facility study. We've also included $650,000 for furniture, equipment, and vehicles. So in summary, when we look at this by fund, included in the budget recommendation is an initial state fund budget of $425 million. This is a slight decrease from the current year budget because, as you can see, the state allotted ADM is going to go down about 333 students. The local current expense fund, or our county fund budget, is $216 million. This reflects the increase of $10 million for a total request from the county commissioners of $212.6 million. It also includes a little bit, $3.3 million, most of which is made up of fines and forfeitures. Our federal grants fund, this is our 2018-19 federal planning allotments. We don't have the 2019-20 federal planning allotments from DPI yet, so we're using the 2018-19. These are just the current year allotments. This does not include carryover here in this number. When we look at the total operating budget, $691.2 million. That's mostly funded. Again, 61% of that's from the state fund. 31% is from local fund or county commissioners, 7.3% is from federal funds. When we look at how those dollars are spent, more than 82% of that spent on salaries and benefits, 9.6% on purchase services, 4.3% on supplies and materials. We have a small sliver of 0.1% on equipment, and then you'll see the transfers to charter schools has increased to 3.3% of that total operating budget for 2019-20. when we look at how we have budgeted broken up by purpose function, you can see that over 80% of this budget is spent at the school level, where you can see 4.8% is in transportation, 1.6% is maintenance, 2.9% is utilities. Again, the 3.3% you'll see is transfers to charter schools. The technology department's 1.3%, and so that leaves 5.2% for the remaining support services to schools. So in total, when we look at the total budget for a proposed budget for 19-20, you can see the total $767.3 million. That's just looks like a slight increase over the 2018-19 budget that the board approved in August of 2018. The state fund budget, you can see again, is decreased slightly due to the reduction in projected enrollment. The local county fund budget reflects the increase that we've asked for. The federal fund budget, it looks like a decrease, but again, the 18-19 number does include carryover, because we have to have the carryover because of the way the different fiscal years end. The 2019-20 proposed budget does not include carryover. You can see in the capital outlay fund, the increase to $12 million from the $6 million we received for the current year. An increase in child nutrition fund, a slight decrease in the ACES fund, slight increase in the special revenue fund due to the most recent grant we received for the arts. So again, that brings our total to about $767.3 million. Next steps, we'll have our public hearing at our regularly scheduled April 30th board meeting. We'll hold the public hearing on the budget at that same time. In that same meeting, we're going to have the public hearing on closing Hampton Elementary School. The Board of Education is scheduled to adopt a budget on May 14th, because statutorily we're required to have that to the county commissioners by May 15th. The county manager, we think, is scheduled to present his budget on May 16th. And the commissioners will do their work to review their budget. I think they'll hold their public hearing on June 6th, and then they typically adopt their budget resolution on the in their last meeting, which is scheduled for June 20th. Our board holds their last meeting on June 27th. If we don't have all of our budget work finalized at that point, we'll have ask the board to approve an interim budget resolution until we can pass a final budget resolution once the local and state budgets are completed. With that, I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you. Before we go to questions, I also want to recognize, I think Senator Michael Garrett is here, and County Commissioner Skip Alston.
I'd just like to provide an update on the status of my recommendation regarding Gateway Education Center. About 6 weeks ago, the new assistant superintendent for special education staff brought facilities concerns regarding Gateway Education Center to me. The concerns primarily centered around constant water intrusion, ongoing issues with water leaks, windows with broken seals that trapped moisture in between the glass panes, water leaking through the windows and doors, and problems with the roof. However, the concerns also included issues surrounding rodents, clogged toilets, and non-functioning therapy pool that has been used to store broken and outdated equipment for several years. The assistant superintendent complained that twice during the year already, custodial staff had to clean raw sewage out of the hallways. Having just testified before the U.S. House of Representatives Committee on Education and Labor, I know that aging buildings with excessive moisture lead to dust, mold, and other airborne allergens that negatively impact indoor air quality, placing students and adults for greater risk of illnesses, asthma, and other respiratory conditions, and reduces students' ability to learn. I immediately informed the Board of Education and ordered a study on indoor air quality at Gateway Education Center. The results of the air quality study on that particular day came back satisfactory, but that is just one day, and it was not raining. The water intrusion and other problems continue. Knowing the impact on children and speaking with facility staff and exceptional children staff, I decided to relocate students while we sort out the building issues and costs, believing, as I have all of my life and career, that we have to keep children safe, particularly our most vulnerable children. I knew that we have three new public separate schools that could accommodate these children. I also learned that we could actually reduce the travel time for the students by ensuring they no longer shared a bus with the students from Herb and Metz. School closings are generally included as part of the process, the budget process, even though there is no savings in reassigning students to another building in this case, because the educational program and services do not change. The staff move with children. As we do each year with the budget, we ensure items that impact school staff and a particular school community are shared with that school community a few days before it is placed on the agenda, so that parents and teachers are not blindsided by the media. My staff, led by the principal, called every family. I have a great deal of respect for the principal there, and she did her best to call, knowing that the process for the budget begins today, and it is not approved for months, and that all of the discussions surrounding what we should do, how we proceed, happen after the first presentation to the board. Any mistakes in communication made by school staff or my communications department, I own. And I apologize for the angst that it has caused these families. But we were trying to make sure that you were not blindsided. And we were trying to make sure we got children to safety. Since that time, parents have provided feedback about various issues and the services they value at Gateway, including our partnership with the Greensboro Cerebral Palsy Association and its infant toddler program, and our pre-kindergarten inclusion programs at Gateway and Haynes Inman, among other topics. So we will offer parents a transfer to one of these three schools, and Gateway parents wishing for students to remain will not be forced to move from a building they love. Our facilities team manages 126 schools, 300 buildings, 3,000 acres of land, and 12.5 million square feet of facilities, as well as sidewalks, driveways, curbs, fencing, security systems, athletic facilities. Our average school building is about 50 years old. We have 469 mobile classrooms, 58% of which are more than 20 years old. We have five mobile units that date to 1972. Our maintenance staff responds to more than 30,000 work orders every year, many for failing HVAC units, plumbing systems, leaky roofs, and other basic building needs. Schools routinely use buckets and trash cans to catch the water during heavy rains like they do at Gateway. Water seepage and flooding is also common, especially since our county has, during the past year, experienced a devastating tornado, two hurricanes, an unusual 12-inch snowfall, and a record 64 inches of rain. The deferred maintenance backlog for just this school district is $800 million. Our current maintenance budget, however, is around $6 million. Per year, which equates to about 50 cents per square foot. The deteriorating condition of our aging facilities requires us to address potential health and safety issues piecemeal and with stopgap measures. For example, we patch leaky roofs and repair outdated HVAC systems innumerable times, but do not have adequate funds for roof replacement or new HVAC systems, which would address the root causes of water intrusion and humidity that cause indoor air quality issues. In short, we make every effort to protect teacher and student health from harm that may otherwise be caused by inadequate or under-maintained facilities, but we do so on a shoestring budget that often does not allow us to provide a truly optimal and healthy learning environment. I say all of that to say this. I've been discouraged to see how these situations pit educators against educators, parents against parents, board members against staff, against superintendents. Please know, I've heard and read comments about who and which students deserve great school facilities, and questioning why the school board in the past has prioritized some construction needs over others. The truth is, every child in America and in Guilford County deserves a great facility. 1/6 of the U.S. population is in a school building every single day. Everybody knows somebody, has somebody in a school building, and they deserve better than what we are offering. And in North Carolina, I know there are dollars to fund the building renovation, repair, and maintenance of public schools. Somebody has to have the will to make sure it happens. I implore us not to turn on one another, but to fight more than ever for adequate school funding and funding to address our crumbling school infrastructure here and throughout this nation. I hope the issue today raises awareness about school funding and aging facilities. And again, I apologize for angst this has caused you. I know you go through enough every single day, but I will never apologize for trying to get children to safety. Thank you.
So board members, I think traditionally what we've done is ask clarifying questions, and then if there's other inquiries or more information, we'll share that with Angie and the superintendent, and then at our next board meeting, you'll share that with the full board?
Certainly.
Kim?
Thank you for your presentation. I heard you calculate that it's 50 cents per square footage that we've been funded. Is that based on the county commissioner's piece? I'm concerned about not just the capital budget. So is that how they also calculate how much they give the schools, or?
So I don't know that the county commissioners use a formula to calculate how they fund capital for school.
Okay.
I just know that we've received $6 million this year, which is an increase from the $5 million that we received last year.
Is there any way that you can show us the same way you showed us, like from 2008 or from a period of time, what county commissioners have given Guilford County?
For annual?
Yeah, annually. I would love to see that data as well. Yeah, I'm only talking about referencing capital funding. And you also mentioned that the market is $1.50.
It's a range from like $1.48 to $1.97.
That's in the private sector, or are you just saying market value?
That's just a standard cost of maintaining a building.
Is that only relative to North Carolina, or
it's nation? It's a
nationwide mm-hmm. data. Thank you.
Question? Okay, there we go. Thank you. I wanted to get clarification so that we're clear, is that the recommendation for that we are not considering the recommendation to close Gateway.
Not closing the school. We will meet with parents about transferring to other school buildings. And as I said, any parent that wants to keep their children at Gateway, we will keep the building open for them.
Thank you.
I first of all want to apologize to the parents and community for the way you've been treated. It was wrong, and I sincerely regret it. If the superintendent really wants to put her money where her mouth is, she will say right now, we need to fix Gateway. We need to put a new roof on there.
I believe we need new windows because there has been water intrusion into the building. So that's all, that's the basics that needs to be done according to our ex-maintenance director who's been here for many years and who knows Gateway as well as all of the other buildings very well. I have confidence in his knowledge to assess the situation. So board, I mean, we can say Alan Branson's here right now. We can tell him, please take some of that $7 million that was leftover bond money and put it towards Gateway and fix it this summer. If we really, really care about those kids, we'll get that school fixed and fixed as soon as possible, and this summer would be a great time. So I'd like to make a motion that we ask the county commissioners to allocate at least $2 million to Gateway to fix it. Going to be said that I am inappropriate and out of order, but I'm not out of order when I'm trying to do what's right for kids and fix a building that needs to be fixed.
I have questions. So there's a motion on the floor. Is there a second?
I don't mind seconding it. My problem is I feel it's unfair to the county commissioners. You need to go to the county. He's hearing this. For us to take a vote and put that on him here, I support you guys. I've seen you open your hearts up. I have seen you let people into your private, and my heart goes out to you, okay? And I apologize for anything and everything that I have done to cause you any problems. But
excuse me, we need to have order. If you want to express your support, please do this so that we can continue to move forward with the meeting. We'd really appreciate that.
We can second it and let the vote happen, and then we'll go from there.
Hold on just a minute. I'm sorry, Elizabeth.
Board to be aware of here, which is that this meeting was noticed as simply a budget presentation for the 2019-20 school year. It's not your regular meeting, and so it hasn't been noticed appropriately to have a vote on something for this school year.
Absolutely. Thank you. So it's not appropriate then to take that vote. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. No, I'm not going to withdraw it.
Well, we're not going to take a vote on it.
Okay, fine.
Winston.
Then you can live
I have questions on the budget, and I can appreciate Darlene's fervor, and I know 2 weeks ago there was also a request that we prioritize a cafeteria building and allocate funding. So I do believe that we need to go through the untenable choices, as untenable as they are, as to weigh those choices and not make them in the spur of the moment. I know that makes for perhaps anger and deep emotion and more advocacy, which I invite and welcome on all issues and from all perspectives. I do believe we need to weigh these incredibly untenable choices that have mounted. So I have questions about this budget, clarifying questions.
Thank you.
Angie, on page 6, I just want to clarify what we're seeing here in terms of the allotments and how allotments work. Which, if the state were still allocating money the way they had typically allocated it, based on their previous formulas, it looks to me like we'd have over 100 positions still in this district, based on the number of students that we have.
That's correct.
Is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So there's been a price that teachers have paid. 100 people aren't here that would be here and have jobs and be serving students. So teachers and students have paid a real price for the increases that they deserve, and they deserve more of. And I encourage the whole community's continued fight for that. So that's a correct read of those allotment numbers. I don't say they lost their jobs, but we'd have more than 100 positions.
Right, and I don't want to imply that it was a trade-off. Most of these reductions were made right after the recession.
But ultimately, that price has been paid.
Absolutely, yeah.
All right. On page 8, where we show our comparative local spending, so that's county spending compared to other counties across the state, is that operating and capital or just operating?
It's just operating.
So is there a way to see the capital as well? As we wrestle with capital expenditures and investments, it would be helpful to benchmark that against some other counties. Because I know we'll have to look at what their tax code is and how they're taxing and how they're creating that revenue, but
so
that'd be
helpful. The survey where we get this information from, the Association of County Commissioners.
Yeah, I'm familiar.
It does include capital. Some of that does capture the debt. So the survey does include capital, but it picks up the debt in there too.
Right.
So we may have a little trouble, but we can go back to old financial reports if we try to. How far back are you?
I've looked at that too, and that's what I found confusing on that website. Mm-hmm. And that spreadsheet that compares it is that some's debt, some's capital. It's just hard to get to some real numbers. So I don't know. I'm curious
about that. Look at so it I'll so keep. What we can find.
All right. Kim asked, I had the same question Kim did about that capital money, so thank you for that and that additional comparison. On the page 16, Title I allotments, I heard you say because of the new formula and the new schedule on that, which in my understanding we're not required to vote on. I mean, we do have to approve an application, but not the formulas, but that no schools who had it would be lost, or more schools will have it?
Correct.
So I know I received a schedule. I didn't dive into it all huge analysis. I looked at it.
So no school is Title I funded this year. All schools that are Title I funded this year will be Title I funded next year. We also were able to add 12 additional schools that are not receiving Title I funding this year, but they will be receiving Title I funding.
So the dollar amounts may change, but people aren't losing funding or falling out of the
category.
Exactly. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Can you just, that term, I find, consumable resources, page 19, can you tell me again what is considered a consumable math? Is that a book or a worksheet, or it's not a computer, I guess. It's not an online resource, unless it's a subscription, I guess.
It's the resources the students use during their instruction. So those have to be replaced and replenished every year.
So with CKLA and the reading curriculum and Foundations,
ARC, yeah. Mm-hmm. Eureka
and the math.
Eureka math, and I think Open Up, yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so all of that are the resources.
Exactly.
And the professional development, we're still investing in that, I see. It's just not an increase over this current year. I mean, we've increased investment in professional development, but we're keeping that level. In the recommendation? That's what the recommendation is?
The recommendation is to continue to use the resources that we've used the current year, next year, continue using those for professional development. We're adding Math 1. We may not offer as many days per school for ARC at this coming year, but we'll redirect some of those resources to include Math 1.
Okay, thank you. I don't think I had a question. I appreciate the information about Hampton and the process for that. So the deferred maintenance and the capital dollars, I do have a question that's not here in the recommendation. So last year, the county commissioners in the two-thirds bond discussion and vote approved $10 million for safety and security. As I recall, there was a public hearing recently I was not able to attend. and it may be that I have to get this information offline or later in terms of how the process for that $10 million and two-third bonds money is expected to be allocated. What are the discussions around that given safety and security? I certainly have schools and parents who were paying attention to that a year ago and excited and interested in how that money could be invested, but have also had frustration, like, we're holding onto their money, and I've said that's not the case, but there's a long process for bond issuance and those dollars getting into projects. So can we get an update at some point of what we can expect from that process and how that $10 million? I remember when we made a request last year to the commissioners, I think it was around $5 million that we asked for in safety and security, but they issued the $10 million and the two-thirds bonds. Right. I know we have more safety and security projects that can be done. Mm-hmm. There were five at the time, as I recall, 4.9 that were identified. Scott's shaking his head, yes, right, my memory right. is correct. Right. So I'd just like an update that on that during this budget process over the next few weeks. That would be helpful.
Sure, we'll get that information.
Can you tell me on page 29, what is included in the federal planning allotment? What are those dollars typically? And it's probably different based on federal, that's probably not federal grants, that's federal allotment. Like, can you tell me that?
So yeah, our two largest federal dollars in the federal grants fund are Title I, which for the current year, that allotment's about $26 million. And then IDEA 6B is our second largest.
Say that again,
IDEA 6B.
6B.
6B, yeah. And that's usually around $16 million. So that makes up the largest part of this $50 million. We do also have some Title II dollars, which are for teacher quality. We've got some Title IV dollars we've got language acquisition dollars in there. We've got
language acquisition for ESL
it is.
Learners,
mm-hmm,
especially.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yeah. But there are some other smaller grants included in that.
And IDEA is for exceptional children,
it is.
Special
mm-hmm.
needs. And,
mm-hmm.
okay. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Linda and then Kim.
I have a fairly straightforward question. And, you know, I know we talked about transportation, but we do have a major transportation issue right now. And to see that we're taking $1 million out of transportation, and I guess yesterday it got by me, you know, I would like more detail on where that money's coming from. I mean, because we are struggling to get our children to school. I get lots of complaints
right,
about
right.
getting our children to school.
So Scott and his team are working with a consultant to do an evaluation of our transportation operation, focusing right now on routing and some other what we feel like are low-hanging fruit. But you'll see if you looked at the numbers that the $1 million we anticipate saving there, we're gonna reinvest in transportation and the bus driver salaries. That'll help us attract, we okay. think, bus drivers to help resolve.
Issue that needs to be addressed.
Certainly.
So when I'm like, wait a minute, I probably didn't ask the right question yesterday on that issue.
Right.
Okay.
And we'll have part of their information from Edulog, the consultants that are helping us to address the latenesses in the buses and the issues with transportation, but they'll be making recommendations about efficiencies in the department that we'll present to the board.
All right. Kim and then Pat.
I believe my question is maybe for the superintendent. Does IDEA ever have any recommendations for capital at all in serving
IDEA funds? I have to look, I'm not sure, but
okay.
most of the entitlements do not allow you to use them for construction.
Okay.
Pat?
Yes, Angie, on page 22, when you wanted to draw attention to that page for the Twilight School, can you talk a little bit more about, I think this is a great example of a real innovative, creative approach on how we can really get the most use out of our dollars. I think everyone here would agree that's something that we value. for our students. I think this is a great example, illustration of that, where we can serve more students that are in that very difficult area of credit recovery, where they're borderline not able to graduate, or they may even be further closer to dropping out due to their grades. Could you share a little more just details? I see the bullet points, but how that's going to work and how many students we're serving and those type of things. I think it'd benefit the community as well to know
certainly
what we're doing.
So it's the Twilight.
The Twilight.
So Angie's a CFO, so I'll answer.
Yeah.
The Twilight program currently serves 63 students for approximately $750,000. The program is highly successful, as you know, but it is not the way in which Twilight traditionally runs, and we believe we can serve many more students. When you look at the number of dropouts on slide 22, for those who are doing the PowerPoint so the public can see that, when you look at the number of dropouts and you know the number of students who are at risk of dropping out because they do not have enough credits at the particular grade level they are in, we can serve many more students if we move to three locations. So we would be able to serve approximately 300 students with the staff we have, which includes teachers, counselor, administrator, social workers when necessary, through a blended model. The current model is blended. It's online and face-to-face. Where students would be at Jackson Middle School, Pruitt-Scale, and Southern High School after the school day is over. We chose these sites because High Point Central, Southern High School, and Smith High School have some of the highest dropout rates in the county. And placing sites closer to those communities will ensure we can recover some of those students who are behind or who have already dropped out.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions? Byron?
Thank you. So I've been speaking with Ms. Garrett here, and the message is we don't want to send to the county commissioners or to the 2,000 students that have applied for CTE, for those CTE signature schools, is that in any type of way that's going to be compromised. And so at the next board meeting, there is going to be a motion made to fund Gateway, or there's an intent to fund Gateway as a separate line item. But we don't anyway want to direct the county commissioners to mess with the over the $7 million recommendation for the CTE schools. And so we do believe that all of our schools matter, all of our children matter, and there is a way to do it. Keep in mind, it has been over a decade since we have had a bond, and so as the superintendent stated earlier, with a capital outlay budget of around $6 million, we cannot fix, repair, and maintain every school in this district. But that doesn't mean that students who have applied and who are ready to start their CT signature schools in the fall may be compromised if that money is dealt with in touch. And so there will be a motion, and Ms. Garrett, of course she can speak for herself, has agreed to withdraw that motion, but it will be made at the next meeting.
Pat?
I have a comment. I think that, you know, when we get into these very significant, meaningful issues, it's very easy to put one another on the spot and score points or whatever, no matter what that issue is. And I think that's a dangerous precedent if we set that as board members, where we, no matter how well-intentioned our meeting is, there are consequences. There are consequences to county commissioners, to staff, to our operations people, to other parents. And it's a ripple effect. And I think we're charged with making responsible decisions in the best interest of students. Clearly, heretofore at Gateway, that was not done. And that's on us, and that's on previous many years back before we got to this moment. We're trying to make it right, and we're trying to be part of the solution. And I've talked to at least probably 40 to 50 parents. Some of you I don't even know that might be in this audience. Thank you. I've learned a lot more during the process. But I hope that as a board, as leaders, we just are careful and judicious about making motions and putting board members on the spot for whatever issues that have resounding effects. And it's certainly well-intentioned, and I respect that. There's a way to do this, and we can get it right. And I'm talking about Gateway, to fix what needs to be fixed. But there's a process that happens to do that. And we need all the brain power and equity and resources and community input that we can have. And we make a snap decision, as popular, as well-intentioned as that is, it can really, really end up hampering our efforts, quite frankly. Although it is packaged as something that's meaningful and well-purposed, it can hamper our real benefit to the students and their families. So I appreciate the withdrawal, and I think it's going to allow us to really enter into deeper discussions and figure out how we solve it. And I think everyone on this board wants to solve it. I know that. So I just wanted to share that with everyone. Thank you.
Thank you. Diane?
I hope that the parents and anyone else in the community actually listen to the conditions which made us, make the decision to ask our superintendent to find a solution for the problem at any of our schools. I don't think we give Dr. Contreras enough credit for her leadership, for the way that she has handled crisis situations. We sit here 1 year after the tornadoes, and within a week, our superintendent was able to find places for 900 students and staff to go. It worked out. She made sure that transportation was made available. Yes, for some of those schools, the distance was a lot further than what the parents were accustomed to. But we are about trying to provide a quality education for all of our students. I think that for us to turn on her or anyone who has said that the safety of children, the quality of their physical being as well as their educational being is not the primary reason for taking this situation and acting on it. I hope that the parents heard that the fact that your children will still be afforded a quality education. They will lose nothing except being in perhaps a different place. We have tough decisions that we have to make. We have limited resources, and as much as we want to say to the county commissioners, give us more money, they have a fiduciary responsibility to decide how much money they feel should be given to education. We need to be more diligent, just like you've been here today, to talk to your state representatives, because as I think Ms. Henry has shown in the slides, there's been a significant decrease in the amount of funding from the state level, okay? And for those who come see me, a lot of times they say, well, what about the lottery? Well, the lottery is not the solution. We have an obligation as taxpayers of North Carolina to have our state legislators fund fully public education without it being siphoned off to charter schools. If I'm not against alternate educational opportunities, but fund those alternate education opportunities with their own pot of money. Do not take $19 million from the public school dollars, because if we had that $19 million, perhaps we could just instantly fix Gateway. But just as you parents are here arguing for us to keep Gateway, we last board meeting, we had this whole place full for parents arguing to give Paige a new cafeteria. Before that, it was another school. So, and if you look at the facility study, we have over, 30 elementary schools that are listed as in poor condition. I don't remember the number of middle schools, but look at that study. I mean, the price tag is $1.8 billion. That is not going to happen overnight. And if you rob Peter to pay Paul today, you are going to wind up cheating Jacob. And we need to understand that. We want your children to be safe. We want your children to be cared for the way you would have them. And I can't imagine any parent in here would want their child sitting in a damp, cold, wet building all day long. Because when you say have maintenance fix it, maintenance has been trying to fix it. I mean, it was described to us that I think in one of the last rainstorms that maintenance was literally taking towels, trying to sop up water in the hallway. Now, you know that that's not an effective way. You know that. So that means that even if they were able to take 100 towels and sop the water up, it was still damp in there. It was still cold in there. It was still wet in there. And for some of our children, you know, just getting a cold can be physically detrimental to them. So let's just be reasonable and understand that I think that if we look at keeping this building open, then those are resources that cannot go to some of the other needs and serve your children. It's not, it never has been about not serving your children. We did not make this decision just like that. We spent the time to look at each individual child, what his or her needs were, what would be, you know, an appropriate setting for them. Please, excuse me.
This is not the time for dialogue back and forth.
What I am saying is, I'm not putting words in your mouth. What I am saying, though, is that take a look at what we're trying to do for the health, welfare, and benefit of the children. And it's not just your children. We are trying. I mean, your specific children at Gateway. And we've got to make tough decisions about what schools will be open, what schools need to be combined. That's what the facility study is about. And if we don't do that, if every time we make a move to try to say, okay, we need to consolidate a school, if everybody gets angry, we will go nowhere, and the quality of our children's education, which is what we're about here, will fail.
Thank you. Byron.
I just want to make the statement regarding Hampton Elementary. A lot of Hampton parents could not be here today because some of them don't have transportation. Many of them have to work 2+ jobs. And the socioeconomic conditions in East Greensboro have not drastically improved. Recently, the Renaissance Co-op was forced to close. And so we are back to being a food desert in East Greensboro. So I wanted to uplift the fact that although Hampton parents could not be here physically, they have been calling, they have been emailing, and the superintendent in her process reached out to, as well as the principal of Hampton, contacted those parents and had conversations. It is difficult to be in the Hampton attendance zone and your child is in Reedy Fork and your child has an asthma attack and you don't have transportation to get to your child. So your child is sent by ambulance to Moses Cone Hospital. And if you have the ability, the money to Uber or Lyft or catch a ride with a friend or neighbor to get to the hospital in order to provide your child's inhaler. So I want to be very clear that Hampton does have a voice. It is strong in spite of the socioeconomic conditions of East Greensboro. And Hampton is a sister school to Gateway, as well as Bessemer and Irwin and Peeler and those schools impacted. So there is only one cross to advocate for, and that is equity for all schools in Guilford County. We all have sacred cows and have schools that we love and treasure, but if something happens to one, it happens to them all. And that is why although we are elected by different districts in this county, we operate as one board for all children. So I wanted to acknowledge the Hampton parents that couldn't be here, that couldn't come out and make posters, that did not inundate us with emails, because most of them don't have internet access and Wi-Fi in their homes, in low-income, high-poverty housing, in those communities that they wanted their school to. Thank you.
Thank you. there are no more questions, I'd like to personally thank you all for coming out. I can imagine how challenging that is and has been and will be for you. My family operated an adult daycare facility for over 15 years. Many of our students had aged out of McKeever and Gateway, enrolled in those programs, and I know it takes very special people to care for and to parent our very special students. So thank you for your communications to us. Thank you for showing up today and sharing your concerns with us. And we do hope that we'll have your cooperation in thinking about 126 schools and how we can do the best for all students. Is there a motion to adjourn?
Mm-hmm.
Second? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you.